Brothers and sisters, welcome to the only ever third episode of the Not-So-Super Bash Bros Presents Game Club. It is August, and that means it was Hans's turn to pick a game for us to come together and review. Hans, what game did you choose?
I choose Ghostbusters.
Yes, Hans chose Ghostbusters, and I'm joined by Alex.
Hello.
And IY.
Hey.
For us to sit here and talk about it. So, for those not in the know, Ghostbusters, the video game, was released in June 2006. That doesn't sound right.
No, it's 2009.
Yeah, 2009. Oh,
I hit the wrong button on my keyboard there, apparently.
Oh, that you made a massive mistake there.
Released on PS3, 360, and PC, and shock horror, it is another third-person shooter.
Hashtag third person shooter.
We've definitely got a nice wee theme going. I hope
hashtag
I doesn't break it later.
Third person shooter club. Yes, so Ghostbusters the video game was what a lot of people would consider, and Dan Aykroyd himself has said, it is essentially the third Ghostbusters movie. No, not that atrocity that was released earlier this year.
Fuck females.
That's not why that was a bad movie. And thank God.
I disagree.
So Hans, why did you choose Ghostbusters the video game?
Because he hates us.
I choose Ghostbusters the video game because I really like it. It's probably one of my favorite games of all time, being a massive Ghostbusters fan. And it's the closest thing to actually becoming a Ghostbuster. Like, they've released other Ghostbuster games, like the Sega game, and they've released a couple of other ones on the last generation and this one. But all of them have been either side-scrollers or top-down shooters. So you don't really get the immersion you would get from a third-person game. So it's really the closest I will ever become, until science catches up with us, to becoming an actual Ghostbuster.
So yes, we came together to play Ghostbusters, and I'd like to do a quick round the room, as we usually do, and see how far everyone got. Real life caught up with me. I had to move house and leave my job. So I got to what I believe would be about two-thirds of the way through the game. I just got to the Return to the Sedgwick Hotel mission. Hans, I assume you completed it?
I completed it within 3 days.
Alex?
Oh boy, did I complete that game.
I completed it yesterday.
Yep. So I got to up that mission today, so it is actually... I played through most of it in the past couple of days, so it is actually really fresh in my head.
I know the answer, but I'm going to ask anyway. Is a level 7, whatever, bad or very bad?
On a scale of 1 to 10, I would say...
Let me guess. It's a 7. Let's just say we're about to get real busy.
So, we'll kick it off here with the first one I kind of want to talk about. And this being a Ghostbusters game, I would like to talk about and see what you guys thought about how this actually represented Ghostbusters and how it really captured the look and the feel of the films. Because personally, I thought it did phenomenally at that anyway. It does feel like if you cut all those cutscenes together, it would just feel like another Ghostbusters film. Like, right down to the music, all the real voice actors return, and I think they actually do a really good job of recreating them in 3D. One issue, though, is I feel like Bill Murray sounds like he's half-assing the entire thing. He just sounds bored.
Yeah, later on in the game, I found that he repeated all of his lines out of context. Like, he'd be walking along, and he'd try and get you to do something. He'd be like, little help over here. And it's like, right. And then he'd just keep repeating that, and repeating that, and repeating that. So, oh, Bill.
Yeah, because, like, to be honest, the two voice acting... Well, three voice acting issues I had were Bill Murray, who does, at times, sound like he's half-assed it. Other times he sounds fine, but there are a couple of lines that are like, come on, put a bit of effort in, you're getting paid for this. The other one is Harold Ramis, but I think it's because his acting style for Egon doesn't really carry across well for voice acting. You know, Egon's character is a very monotone character. Like, he doesn't emote a lot.
Yeah.
And to do that as a voice acting thing, it's difficult. The other one I had a real issue with wasn't because she was half-assing it, and it wasn't because her character is that. It's that fucking... that woman. Is it... the actress called Melissa Milano or Alyssa Milano or something? The love interest of Peter Venkman.
Eliza?
She is...
what's her name?
Yeah. She is so bad.
Yeah.
Like, just... so, like, she was... she's not a bad actress in real life, but it's one of those things where... being an actor or actress doesn't carry across to being a voice actor, it just because it's just it's two different sets of skills. But saying that, Dan Aykroyd and Ernie Hudson did fantastic jobs. So they did.
But I think from away from the voice acting, even just like all the musical cues and like the stings sound really good, and it does well. An issue is obviously you're the rookie in this game, and you're kind of a silent protagonist. So there are a couple of times in all the levels where you are kind of left, like you get separated from the rest of them and you get some sporadic things over the radio, and the game kind of just feels really lifeless in those sections. Because your character doesn't, like, he doesn't even make grunts or anything half the time. Like in the very first level in the Cedric Hotel with the fisherman, you get knocked over a couple of times there and you just literally fall over. There's no like, it's just fall over, no noise or anything, and it just feels like really weird.
I actually kind of like it, because I feel like having a mute character in games can lead to a lot of funny moments. Like, if you look at South Park Stick of Truth, you know, your characters are mute in that, and they constantly point out the fact he doesn't talk, and it is weird, and I think it was really funny. Like, you know, seeing a man, a full-grown man, go completely ragdoll without making a noise, to me, just really made me giggle, and, like... the comedy, which is actually really strong in throughout the game, like of him being a mute, like, and not talking to Venkman or Dan Aykroyd or whoever, I think it actually just really adds to the character. Plus, maybe it's because I like id humor, but I just find it really charming as well. Like, same with the minions and sort of thing, you know, they don't talk, so I find that comedy quite charming.
My issue with that is it's not haha, this is funny kind of a laugh when I see that. It's, oh, this is just ridiculous. Like, I don't think they're trying to be funny doing that. Like, you mentioned a Stick of Truth there. All their humor around the silent protagonist and people making wisecracks about it is all very intentional. But when you see your character fall over, just flop like a dead fish, it's more, oh, this is just silly.
It's a bit odd, though. Do you not think how you're talked to throughout a lot of the game, using whatever nickname they want to give you to call you a greenhorn, but yet your character doesn't reply to anything? Like, it's one thing to be silent, but like, it's another thing whenever like characters are specifically talking to you or ordering you, and your character's just whatever.
You know, if it was anything but a video game, I would agree. But again, look at the likes of Stick of Truth, you know, or even friggin'... a really good obvious one, Legend of Zelda. Link never speaks, and people are talking to him constantly.
The difference in Legend of Zelda, not so much Stick of Truth, because it is kind of a running joke in that. In Legend of Zelda, there's implied responses by Link, though. You just don't see them, which I think is the difference in this, where the most of a response you get from him is a shrug or a weird look.
Like, when you compare it to Stick of Truth did it on purpose to set it up for the whole... running joke,
yeah,
that you
for the final stinger at the end, yeah, of Stick of Truth, that is the running joke.
Do you think maybe it's an issue because they've designed a character that's supposed to sit in this world, so that instead of, because if you made a character for voice or made a brand new character, like, they need to compete against all the other Ghostbusters,
yeah,
and all the other expectations. But in doing this, do you think maybe this is why they did it, so that you are kind of like, although you are the main character in some ways, you are also like a guy watching this unfold. Maybe that's... I think we're dwelling on this a bit too much, but I think it's an interesting thing to talk about. I guess we should ask the question, you know, why couldn't it have been... why am I not playing the other four?
I think what they wanted to do was keep the thing of you're watching the Ghostbusters. Because if you are a Ghostbuster, you're not watching the Ghostbusters. So I think they wanted to bring the element of observation in. But then at the same time, to counter my own argument, why do they have so many solo sections? It's kind of like...
This game did go through developmental hell a bit. They had... Essentially what happened was they actually had the finished game, but... Because it wasn't Volition who did this originally, it was someone else.
Volition didn't make the game at all, Hans.
No, they produced it.
Sorry,
it was Terminal...
Terminal Rally of developers.
Yeah, but whoever was producing it... Because Atari produced this, didn't they?
Yeah.
So Atari bought... Yeah, published it. So I think Atari wasn't its original publisher. But so I think the last publisher said, no, there wasn't enough content to it to warrant a release. And so that's why they actually... A lot of the solo stuff is actually stuff that was added while they were in developmental hell, so it was.
Oh, yeah.
Or so to speak.
I could tell there's a lot of filler. Because the game could have ended a lot sooner than it did. Like, the last Central Park. Oh! Right, Central Park was the worst level I've ever played in any video game ever. It did not need to exist.
Well, hello there. Ray, you guys all right? Man, there ain't nothing dead in this group.
Thanks for joining the party.
So do we want to, like, talk about the gameplay then?
Yeah.
Well, no, Alex says that you're very smoothly, you know, mentioned it, right?
I was going to say, can we talk about the larger structure and then we'll dive into the moment-to-moment gameplay? Because I think the game comes across as a... Well, at the start anyway, in the first, I'd say, two chapters, which I feel like the chapter's gone way too long. It's the same issue that I have with Alan Wake. I feel like each of the chapters lasts far too long for what you're actually doing.
The last couple are a lot shorter. Contrary to what Alex might say, the last two are a lot shorter.
The last boss is fine. The Central Park is awfully long, too long, and I can't remember the one before it.
Sedgwick? No.
It's the island.
The island, it was just awkward.
But overall, like, I think those first two chapters, especially in Sedgwick and then outside the Sedgwick, are kind of more just a greatest hits of Ghostbusters, between recapturing Slimer, going to the Sedgwick Hotel, Stay Puffed. It all just kind of feels like a greatest hit to Ghostbusters before it goes into its own stuff. But I feel like once it goes into its own stuff, this is also where it gets a lot weaker. Because I feel like when you're not traveling through, memories and nostalgia, the game, all the areas and the structure itself really drag on. Because I feel like the museum and the library missions just kind of like meld together in my head and I can't distinguish between them. Because they looked the exact same.
I would like to say I had an issue with the library. Right? Do you know, as you're approaching the final area of the library, you're in the basement, and the wee, like, lectern floats around the room, spawning stuff? So, I got to that bit, and I got to the very last section of it spawning stuff, and all the ghosts came out, fair enough, you know, that's okay. Got to the last ghost. One of the AI thought it'd be a good idea to slam it into a bookcase where it got stuck. And I could not finish the level. So I had to restart it and do that entire sequence again.
We'll talk more about the AI when we go into the gameplay, but on the overall structure and lengthwise, does anyone else have anything they want to raise?
There is.
Stay long.
That's not Alex, you mean, right?
I'll say that as well, because I would say up to where I got to, I felt like the game was dragging on.
Like, I think it threw all of its good things in the first two chapters. After that, it's just, it's the same thing recycled.
Yeah, it does. I'll agree that. Yeah, it seems very front loaded.
Yeah.
To try and hook people in.
Let me stop Alex's vendetta here, right? But one thing actually Alex did point out to me, right, which I didn't realize until it actually happened to me, was did any of you guys try to start a mission? Okay, sorry. So you finish a mission, right, and you get back to the station, right? You get back to the HQ, right? Right. Did anyone try to leave the game and start again?
Yep, did it every time.
Because what ends up happening is you go straight into the next mission.
Oh.
You actually skip past.
I missed so much story because of that,
And then you just go straight in. You actually spawn in wherever you start. It's kind of minor, but at the same time, it's a bit of a weird trigger.
Yeah, I missed setup for 3 or 4 chapters because of that. I thought, oh, this must be just a weird glitch, and then no, it just kept happening, and I can't go back, so.
Well, my biggest disappointment that I thought for missing, right, was actually the reception lady. Because that was actually one of my favorite parts of the game, was the in-between bit where she's, like, answering a call or whatever.
Yeah.
That was one of my favorite bits.
Hello, Ghostbusters. Yes. I don't think so. No, it didn't just stop working, and it doesn't just need toner. It literally exploded after it screamed obscenities at me. No, I don't think the nature of our business has anything at all to do with whether or not you honor your product's warranty.
So, on to the gameplay itself, which this is obviously going to be... Well, I kind of hope this will be the least contentious part, because, boy howdy, I'm not going to lie, this game gets boring real fast.
Well, let's talk about the start of the game, whenever like it how did that make you feel whenever you got that proton pack?
Being a Ghostbuster, your basic proton stream, it's cool. You're a Ghostbuster, it feels awesome. But when you're doing that in every single combat encounter, for at least the first 2 missions...
It's amazing and it's cool for the first ghost.
Yeah.
The 501st ghost, it's...
It's awesome for like the first couple of ghosts, and you're like, I have to do this for, I'd say, 75% of the enemies I encounter is shoot them down, throw the trap out, slam them a couple of times, put them in the trap, rinse, repeat.
And the other 25%, you just shoot them with the bin.
Yeah, until they die and you don't actually need to trap them.
Yeah. Once again, it's front-loaded, because once you get over the initial, oh, this is awesome, it's like, oh, this is the game, huh? It's not... It just gets real old real fast. And that's a shame because it's such a cool weapon.
Yeah, like the first time you do it, it is cool. It feels like, oh, this is probably what it actually feels like to try and wrangle one of these ghosts. But then it's just every single time. I feel like it might have been countered a bit if there was maybe less enemies you had to trap. Like, as I know it's fun throwing trap out and getting them in it, but it becomes monotonous when you're doing it more or less for every single enemy, at least for the first 2 levels.
Oh, it's monotonous throughout the entire game. Especially when you're trying to do it and your allies pull them out of the trap. Did anyone have that happen to them? Because they did it every bloody time I tried to trap something.
Oh, I like my allies when it came to trapping.
Hans, you're being oddly quiet.
No, the combat didn't bother me as much. It wasn't the high point of the game. But like I didn't mind it. Like, different enemies having to swap between your 4 weapons, essentially, to counteract whatever enemy you're facing. So obviously some of them ghosts were weaker against other or certain weapons, and some of them were resistant and stuff. So like, you know, I thought the variety of enemies was actually not too bad. Like, plus the design of the enemies was actually really cool. Like, I love the golems. You know, the enemies are made up of like different objects, like the book golem or the lava golem and stuff. Like, you know, that's a bit different because you gotta slow it down with the blue beam, and then shotgun blast it with the alternate blue beam, and then once it's low enough, you know, rip its head off with the Wrangler beam. So to me, I actually didn't mind the combat. I felt like, you know, it was. I felt like it was kept interesting by having to learn what weapon to use on what enemy, and just yeah. So actually, it didn't bother me as much as it seems to have bothered you guys.
I'll be honest, Hans. See, you know the way it introduced all the counter weapons. I went through that entire game, used the counter stuff when it prompted me to, and the original beam was so much faster to do everything.
Maybe that's why you didn't like the combat, Alex. Maybe if you had slimed them, right? Maybe if you had
slimed them, yeah. The greatest weapon in the game, slime.
Yeah.
Well, actually, when you're facing the ghosts that come out of the black ooze and stuff, you're supposed to slam them because it like knocks their health down in like 2 seconds.
Oh yeah, no, like in those, but in the case of like using the slow stuff, I never slowed anything. Like it just
I slowed the golems because like I remember the first time I played this game, I did what you did, just went for the Wrangler beam for everything. And the first golem I faced, I was just like, you know what? If this motherfucker hits me one more time and ragdolls my ass, I'm a bust a nut. So the second time round, I was like, no, wait, I can slow him down so that I can get away from him to attack him then, and then he won't ragdoll my ass.
Hey, look at this. Hans Davis, professional Ghostbuster.
So I'm going to bring up a point because I know IY has a very nice comparison to make here. So it was brought up briefly there. The four different types of weapons you get. And the way they're the proton beam, you get your stasis one, which doubly lacks as a shotgun, and then you get your other, you get your slime, and then you get the end, you get your rapid fire one. Now, IY, what is the comparison you'd like to make here?
What do you mean? Like, what was the conversation?
I believe you found another game that also feels like this, in the way that this kind of just feels like shoehorning in ways to bring in third person weapons. You've got your shotgun, you've got your machine gun, you've got your basic weapon.
Yeah, I did think it was... Because at the start of the game, you get your proton beam, and it's like, yeah, I'm a fucking Ghostbuster. Then it's like, okay, well, now you can use the other button.
No, I've just got this fucking shotgun.
Well, before that, it's like, oh, here's like a grenade launcher thing.
Oh,
it's, yeah. It's like, oh, okay, like so an AoE. It's like, okay, that makes some sense. And then it's like, here, I activated this new thing on your pack. It's like, the shock blast. It's like, oh, it's a fucking shotgun, right? So then it's like, okay... Fair enough, but then of course it does not pass the shotgun test, right? Like, and that's the issue I have. I think Hans
worst
made a good point.
Shotgun on Game Club so far.
I think Hans made a good
by
point
a
actually,
mile.
That I think the enemies look very cool. I think they did a very good job with that, and I think the whole idea of scanning to then find a weakness and then using that weapon, I think that's a really good thing to be able to do. But then using those weapons, it didn't feel great. Like, you know, sitting there shooting this shotgun, which didn't really do much. Like, shooting slime at them constantly, which looks really just kind of weird. Right? Let's be honest.
Yes, the issue I had with slime was you could never really tell how far it was going. Because it had, like, a drop-off. So you could be trying to shoot something and you actually weren't hitting. But you'd still see the health and all pop up. It just wouldn't go down. I thought that was really weird. So the comparison I'm trying to get out to make is because we talked about this before, and we believe it was Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, the video game.
What?
Yeah.
So they released Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, and it was around the time that Gears of War was getting, like, Gears of War 2 or maybe 3 had just come out. So they literally just made Harry Potter Gears of War. You just had, like, a rapid-fire wand, you had a shotgun blast for your wand.
You had a sniper rifle wand,
yeah,
right?
You just had different spells that acted as different weapons, and this is what Ghostbusters the video game feels like. It feels like Gears of Ghostbusters of War. Because you're just getting all these equivalents that would be in a normal third-person shooter, and they're
that's
just
pretty good,
shoehorning
yeah.
it into a Ghostbusters theme.
At the same time, you know... Let's be honest here, right? We're complaining about the combat now, but could you imagine if you only had the proton beam? Obviously, that's how Alex played it, but like, could you imagine if you just went through the entire game and it was like, there was nothing new. There was no progression. It was just zap this ghost.
So, the final thing I would like to bring up about gameplay is... Well, sorry, there's actually two things. So first, the AI, which was briefly talked about. I've never...
AI? Have I got a picture for you? So... As you can see, you know, the AI shooting his slime. Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Notice that he's not shooting at the boss in the background.
Oh, look, because he's turning to talk to you.
Nope.
Right?
No, he is not.
Staring at you.
Yep.
He's like
staring at me.
Cross.
Shooting away from the boss. No worries.
Look, just because, just because Ernie Hudson, right, is just being very polite while he talks to you. Like, he doesn't want to, like, he wants to look you in the eyes while he's talking to you.
In the middle of a boss fight?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like look at the background. The other guys have it handled. Right.
You say other guys? There's one beam, IY.
There's two.
No, sure.
I see
look
two.
Right back. You see two
trails? The slime trails, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, can you explain? Why can't he aim at him and turn his head then?
Why are you not shooting Alex? I think you're the one who's not pulling his weight here.
Because I was taking a screenshot.
Hold on, guys. I gotta take a photo.
Let me just whip out my iPhone here.
Cause I just got hit, right? Because, yeah, I think on that one you have to... There's something... I can't remember. But... Just got hit. Stood up. And that's the side I saw. I was like, what the hell is he doing? Because that was going on for like a solid minute. I was like, what the... I was like, I have to take a screenshot of this.
So, the other thing, I've never seen a game that has such erratic AI. Like, there are times I feel like the AI is brilliant in the game. Like, they're actually really helpful and they're really reactive and do stuff. And there are other times, like Alex is pointing out, where they are completely useless. Like, there was times where, I think it's that, what's the boss fight in the museum?
Oh, when they use it, the black,
yeah,
black
where, like,
ooze,
the black ooze
producing
corner.
Plant thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Camera, it's that boss fight. And every so often the guy will disappear and goo guys will come up. And I swear I saw Bill Murray just running around in circles trying to shoot the boss that was underneath the ground.
Oh yeah, I saw that in that fight as well.
It was... The AI is so good at times, but it's also so terrible at times.
I actually feel like that's what Bill Murray would actually do in real life if he was there.
What Bill Murray would actually do would not make a good video game. Is there any final points someone would like to bring up before we wrap this up and do conclusions?
I have a positive.
Oh!
It has more elevator banter than Mass Effect.
That is true.
Worst shotgun, but best elevators.
The line I wrote, right, because when I first game yesterday, there's a line I actually wrote down, which I thought was quite funny. I don't think it was there for humor. But whenever you're at the... Is it the museum? No, it might not be the museum. Either way, it's whenever your woman gets, like... It's whenever you first meet the possession ghosts.
Yeah, that's the Star of the Museum.
Okay, and one of the ghosts, like, grabs your woman... I think it's whenever you actually come back to the start of it.
Yeah.
And one of the characters, I think it was Ernie Hudson's character, his line of block the exits. So how do you hell do you block exits on a ghost? Exactly. For this entire game, it's like all this scientific stuff about how you capture ghosts and shit. And then this line of block the exits. And it's like, well, I guess the person they've got can't go
through it, would they be able to ghost them through a wall, or would they just hit against the wall?
Yeah, but I say, that'd be terrible. If you block the exit and then they try to go through, you break the person's neck to be like, weak!
It's just a small thing, but I just thought it was really funny whenever I heard it. I just thought, wait, what?
Oh, God.
We eat gods for breakfast. Deactivating the cross stream governor. I never thought I'd say this again. Cross the stream!
We eat gods for breakfast?
Too much, you think?
No, I liked it.
Wrapping up time. Personally, I would, if you're a fan of Ghostbusters, play this game and stick it on easy and just blow through it in 4 to 6 hours. It's, or at least play the first two chapters anyway. It's front loaded. Those are where the Ghostbuster nostalgia hooks are there. And within those first two chapters, the combat is at least semi interesting till the end of it. Past that, the game drags and it starts trying to build its own canon rather than using the original canon, and that's when it kind of starts falling apart. If you want to play the whole game, play it easy, or just play the first two chapters. I wouldn't recommend playing the whole game.
I think that, okay, well, we've all discussed it to the end here, but obviously the combat wasn't great, so, but at the same time, you know, this is a movie video game. Or not. I don't know how you want to look at it. But in terms of like the little details they put out, like there's some of the things Hans mentioned, and like I find there was a lot, and I mean a lot of voice acting in this. So at least on those kind of points, it looks as though they really did try, right? Like, gameplay-wise, not great. But I feel like, as Nick said, if you're a fan of Ghostbusters, this is not the worst thing ever. And let me put it this way. A lot more of us finished it than Alan Wake. So,
an infinite number more of us finished it than Alan Wake, considering none of us finished Alan Wake.
But, you know, it's... I feel, but, you know, Nick's pointed out that, you know, the front part is the best part, but whenever it is just nostalgia, it's like, well, why don't you just watch the movie then, at that point? If it's that rehash kind of thing. I don't think it's the worst thing in the world, but... You know, unless you're a big fan of Ghostbusters, I probably wouldn't recommend this.
We'll go Alex then, Hunt, so we can end on a positive. Alex?
I would recommend it only if it's dirt cheap, so you can play the first two chapters, because first two chapters, I mean, they're alright. They're not awful. But third chapter is, like, god-awful. First two, like, even if you are a fan of Ghostbusters... It's like, you might as well just watch the movies, because... Or even go on YouTube and watch the cutscenes from this. Because the gameplay doesn't really add much to the whole Ghostbusters experience. Like, sure, like, there's some dialogue here and there that, you know, reasonably funny, but overall, yeah. Avoid it unless you are, like, desperate for some Ghostbusters.
Hans?
I love this game. I know, like, and I will be the first to admit, like, it is flawed. It's not a perfect game. But I love this game because of the modern miracle that it even exists. I mean, this game went through development hell and was very close not to coming out. Not to mention that, you know, Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis said they were not going to ever do a third film, and that the fact that this is, you know, this is written by Aykroyd and Ramis, this is the third film. Obviously, it's a bit different because it's got to incorporate gameplay and stuff, but like this, the fact that this exists to me is a modern miracle. Like, you know, I would have never assumed I was going to see those four guys again with that music soundtrack and hearing the Ecto One horn and, like, or Ecto One siren and stuff, you know. So to me, I will always hold a soft spot for this in my heart. And if you're a Ghostbusters, like, this came out in 2009.
Yep.
With the original Ghostbusters coming out in like 1986. Like, if you're my age and grew up with Ghostbusters like I did, like watching the cartoons and watching the movies and all that jazz, this game, you'll love this game because it's Ghostbusters, the Ghostbusters that I fell in love with. And if you're my age, like I said, it's worth playing.
So, mixed opinions, I'd say, are all around. There are positive aspects to this game, but there are also negatives, as there are with many games. However...
So, Nick, are we doing the list? The game club list?
I don't mind if we're on our list. But I think listing this will just add, like, another 10 minutes onto this.
Well, no, like, well, just... I personally, at the minute...
How about this caveat? I say we all keep personal lists, and then say, like, every five episodes, we compare personal lists.
Alright, okay. That's fair enough. Four, because then that's one round.
Every time it comes back to me, we'll compare our personal list of how would we rank these games. Does that sound good to everyone?
Okay.
But why are we ranking them? What's the point of ranking these?
People love lists, IY. Lists get views. They make that internet money.
And speaking of making money, IY...
Yes, so the final
piece
of business.
What? I'm going to join hands on this here, right? What?
What is your game?
The final piece of business we have to attend to for the August episode of Game Club is September. The end of summer. IY, it is your turn to pick. What is your game for the September Game Club?
One, I wanted to make sure the game was not a third-person shooter. Right?
Yes!
But then I thought about how Because I liked the way Hans picked his game in a way, because it was like, oh, there's this new movie, don't go see it, guys, but play this video game. I liked how he sort of brought in real life for us all, right? So,
kind of topical.
Yeah. So Nick, you are back home, correct?
Yes, I am back living.
You're back home. All right. Now, and of course, I would be the inverse in that I might be moving away from Belfast soon, right? Yes. So I want to hang out with my Bash Bros, okay? So, contrary to what I told Alex I was going to pick, because I actually changed it.
Bit and switch.
Right, I thought this was really good, because this is a game I wanted to play, and the only person that owns this game that I can see is Hans.
Okay.
Right? Oh.
And the reason why it's so cheap is because this is a co-op game.
Oh.
So, in reality, Nick has to pay nothing. And I've already bought the game.
Wait, so am I the one who's going to have to spend money?
No, I just said I already bought the game. So the two of us will play it.
Yes,
and then so we're
teaming up.
Because we're going to be watching Death Note and shit anyway. So we might as well play some video games while we're at it. So I have picked a game released 9th September 2015.
Oh, recent.
By Asteroid Base.
Do I know this game?
Oh, shit, I think I know what it is.
And so I have picked Lovers in a Dangerous FaceTime.
Oh, no!
Yes! Yes! Because... Oh, me and Hans had such a great time on that, didn't we, Hans?
It's really funny when you can hear Hans in the other scream and then in your headset hear him scream. It's great.
Oh, yeah. That was,
I thought
that was so
it would be
fun.
A good way to, you know, bring the brothers together. And I mean, I get to see Alex, you know, before maybe I go, you know.
Hey, Hans, drop me as your teammate.
I'm going to crash this fucking ship into an asteroid over and over again. I fucking did not like that game.
Yes.
Then again, maybe it was because Alex was my co-pilot.
No, you didn't like me
so...
in that game.
Yeah, you are. Good luck with that, IY.
And this is the discussion I wanted to make. Maybe the game's not bad. Maybe it's just our partners.
Yes, so there it is. In September, we will be teaming up to play Lovers in a Dangerous Space-Time. But for now, for August, we say goodbye. It's a goodbye from Hans.
Yeah, whatever.
It's a goodbye from Alex.
Yeah!
And it's a goodbye from IY.
Bye.
Goodbye from me. See you next time.